Are you ready? Sea of Red, it's time for another episode of Fireside Chat.
It's March 1st, which means the trade deadline is come and gone, and we have a jam-packed show talking about new faces and old faces departing and everything to do with the Flames this past week. And as usual, I'm Dan alongside my co-host Matt. How you doing, Matt?
Good. It was a good week off the ice, not so good a week on the ice, but that's the reason why it was such a good week off the ice.
Well, let's look at the on-ice first and talk about the week that was for the Flames, and then we'll get into the deadline and all the other moves. Flames have played 5 games since we talked last, and unfortunately, they weren't able to even manage a win in any of those 5. Matt, what's their record in the last 10 games?
1-8-1. Not good.
I think 1-8-1 is how you spell Matthews, isn't it?
Yeah, something like that. Might be Lene or Puljujarvi. Not really sure yet on the spelling yet.
Puljujarvi makes sense because we got all sorts of guys with weird names on our team now, so just add him to it too.
Yeah. Let's mess with all the announcers around the league. Get all the really confusing names conglomerated into our team.
Maybe we'll have to import some announcers from overseas.
Yeah.
All right, well, let's break these games down. The first one on the agenda was the Calgary Flames taking on the Los Angeles Kings. And the Kings, much better looking team than they were last year. Last year, the Flames, if you remember, had a big win over them at the end of the year. And this team is looking like a playoff team again. Luke Shen and Anze Kopitar scored for the Kings. All the scoring happened in the second period. And Monahan got the only goal for the Flames that night. Surprising, I think, that Joni Ordio was the goaltender in this one. What did you think of Ordio's performance?
He was the only reason why that game wasn't closer to double digits. With how Jonas Hiller had been struggling in prior games, his ability to shut the Kings down, even the 2 goals that he surrendered, one was a shot that was screened, the other was a weird bounce that landed on Kopitar's stick with a wide open net. Nothing he could do on either. And he was the only player that seemed to be giving it their all in that game.
Yeah, I mean, even if you look in the first period, the Flames let way too many good shots in on Ordio, and they weren't able to get a shot. They got 3 shots all period, and they let 13 of them in on Ordio, and I'd say probably 8 of those could have been scoring chances.
Yeah, and any time you're giving up 30 shots after 2 periods, that's not usually going to be a good game for you.
No. Were you surprised after what we saw from Joni Ordio early in the year that we saw such a good performance?
Absolutely. Like, you and I have discussed regularly about, like, the Flames moving on from Ordio potentially due to his poor play and going in a different direction, and yet he puts up that kind of effort against the Kings and then subsequently against the Islanders and even again tonight against Boston. It's nice to see him doing that. If he would have been playing at that level for the entire season, perhaps the Flames wouldn't be in the position they are in, but, you know, we'll see.
I do think, though, that this might buy Ordio another contract. If he can keep playing this way for the rest of the season, I think the Flames might say, you know what, we'll bring the guy back. He's an RFA. He might not, you know, get a starting job, but I think he might win himself another contract.
Well, the thing is, if he only plays, I do believe, 8 more games or less, then he'll actually be a Group 6 UFA. So the Flames need to make sure that he gets a total of 28 games where he's playing at least 30 minutes in each in order for him to qualify as an RFA.
Okay. Well, they can do it. I mean, it's not like there's, you know, a playoff pressure going on there.
True.
So, you know, if they want him to have it, they'll do it.
Mm-hmm.
Not much else, I don't think, to say about the Kings game. Any other points, high or low, you want to point out on this one?
Not particularly. We got beat by a good team.
Yeah, and you could tell on the ice that we got beat by a good team. One thing I thought the Flames did do well here was they had some pretty good pressure in the neutral zones. Not really where you'd normally want your pressure, but I thought they were making the Kings move further to the outside than they wanted to be in the neutral zone. It didn't help them a lot, because once the Kings got over the blue line, they were still pretty dominant.
Yeah. You can tell one team's a Stanley Cup contender, and the other's, you know, in the Matthews sweepstakes.
For sure. Well, then let's move on to the second game of the week. This was one that I was hoping in our game that the Flames would win, and they had the New York Islanders, who they were playing. Team we don't see a lot of, and there was hope here. I mean, it was tied 1-1 at the end of three, and Josh Bailey ended up winning in the 3-on-3 overtime. The Flames couldn't get it done with Johnny Gaudreau in 3-on-3 overtime, and again, we saw Joni Ordio in net, and I thought another great performance by Ordio in this one.
I thought that the Flames were able to keep John Tavares at bay. Usually when we play him, he victimizes us frequently, and usually not the game usually does not end in a positive result, and the one time he managed to elude a defender was in overtime, and that allowed him to set up Bailey all by himself in front of the net for the game winner. Beyond that, I thought that was a lot better of an effort from the Flames. I thought they controlled the game for most of the evening.
The second period in this game was quite action-packed and a lot of fun to watch. Even though the Flames didn't score, there was a lot of good chances. There was a lot of good play on all the ends of the ice. I really enjoyed those 20 minutes.
Mm-hmm. It was one of the more exciting 2-1 games you'll ever see.
And in the first 40 of this game, pretty even for shots. In the first period, the Flames and the Islanders tied at 12-12. And in the second period, the Calgary Flames beat the Islanders 11-10 for shots. And in the third, it was 9-7 in favor of the Islanders. So pretty even as far as shots go there.
Yeah. And once again, Ordio didn't have a chance on either of the goals that he surrendered.
No, I think that first one was even partly Ordio's fault.
Yeah.
But, you know, he's playing. We have to remember that he's still playing for a team that's not helping him out in a lot of ways. It's not like it's Joni Ordio coming into the Chicago Blackhawks or the LA Kings. I mean, there's a lot of mistakes being made all over the ice. A lot of major penalties in this game, too. We saw Lance Boma get a fighting major. Brian Boley got a fighting major. Boley got another fighting major in the second. So I can't remember the last time we saw a Flames fight, much less three of them in one game.
Yeah, I know. It felt like we got teleported back to, like, 2008 or something like that.
2008 in, like, a Battle of Alberta, where we used to see the gloves dropped every couple minutes.
Yeah.
So, and it's, you know, it's guys that you wouldn't expect either. Like, you know, I wasn't expecting Boma to fight. I guess you expect that from Boland. That's why he's being paid. But him and Matt Martin got into it twice. So I don't know if there's some previous bad blood there or what's going on.
Well, the first fight just ended very quickly. So, like, each of them's like, well, that was lame. Let's go back at it.
Maybe. Anything else about this game you want to talk about?
Not particularly. Yaroslav Halak was good. That's about it.
Halak, yeah, he looked pretty good. The Flames took on the Ottawa Senators. It's another team we don't see a lot of. And this was a high-scoring game, the first real high-scoring game on both sides. It was a 6-4 win for the Senators.
Well, and each of the games recently against Ottawa have been really bizarre. So the fact that it was another high-scoring one, like last year when we were in Ottawa, that was that game we were down 4-0 halfway through the third period and pushed it to a shootout. So just weird games with them.
And this is one that I thought, based on the way they were playing and the way Ottawa was playing, the Flames could have won. They outshot Ottawa significantly. They outshot them 12-4 in the first period, and they were up 2-1. Not only up 2-1, but one of those was a power play goal, which we don't see a lot of from the Flames. But we had Colborne score a power play goal and Monahan score an even strength goal. And then in the second period, I mean, we got up here after Gaudreau scored twice to a 4-2 lead.
And then Mika Zibanejad happened.
Yeah. Well, yeah, I mean, he got three in a row. He got his 12th, 13th, and 14th, and then the empty netter, they scored four unanswered goals in the third period, which put us away. But I was not expecting that. You know, Zibanejad scored one. I thought, okay, you know, it's 4-3. Then he scored again. I'm like, okay, it's tied. The Flames will fire back based on how they'd been playing.
Yeah, and then no, that didn't happen. No. So,
The second Zibanejad goal was a weird bounce. I mean, that was, you know, it wasn't a great goal. It was a weird bounce off Ordeo, and there was some missing stick. And
yeah.
But a goal is a goal, right?
Yep. Oh, I know. And, like, Ordeo, he was reacting as if the guy that he had contact with had the puck and was trying to stop his shot, not realizing that the puck was on the other side of the ice until it was too late.
And,
not much you can do.
No, not much you can do at all. So, you know, it's another loss for the Flames. I thought a good effort. Like, it wasn't like the other two where they didn't seem like they cared. The Flames seemed, even when they got down, you know, to 4-4, they still seemed to me like they were playing pretty much the same consistency for all 60 minutes.
Yeah, I can't argue with you there. I thought that they had a good effort. They should have won. It just didn't happen that way. And if this was last season, they would have easily taken that one. But this team seems like any time anything happens that's in a negative light, they tend to fall apart, especially late in games.
Yeah, you're right. And that's, I think, where some of the Flames' troubles come is late in the game, they don't seem to have the mental fortitude to make it through 60 minutes of hardship.
Yeah. It's like the polar opposite from last year.
And we're often seen midway through the second and then early in the third, it's like they go, oh, we're down. Okay, let's just pack it up and head home mentally.
Mm-hmm.
The next game of the week, the Flames took on the Flyers in Philadelphia. They started their road trip. And this was the game that was on trade deadline day. This was after the deadline was over. The Flames took on the Flyers and lost 5-3. And again, a game that I thought the Flames didn't play too bad, all things considered, with what was going on and the mental state of all these guys.
And then the second period happened.
Well, that's it. I mean, it was 1-1 after the first period. Second period, Simmons, Shen, and Shen got, and Shen scored again, so Shen got two and Simmons got one. Three unanswered goals. But, you know, in the third, though, to their credit, the Flames did fire back with two more.
Yeah.
I thought a decent goal for Ferland and pretty much what I expected from a Frolik goal.
Yeah. Well, the team played a little better at times. They were a defensive mess, though, pretty much throughout the contest. And, like, they pretty much left Hiller out to dry quite a few times.
Yeah, and I think, too, there was a lot more for, probably not so much for Philadelphia, but for the Flames, a lot more going on mentally in this game. I mean, they'd lost some big pieces on their team over the last couple days and that day, and I think there's probably a lot that was going on in their heads where maybe they weren't as focused as they could have been. And if this game wasn't on deadline day, I think that the Flames might have been able to win this one.
Quite possible. What do you think of Garnet Hathaway making his NHL debut?
Not the kid I probably would have called up, but I thought that he knew his role. And I've talked a lot about, you know, knowing your role when you come up and getting that start and understanding what you need to do to stay here. I was surprised he played 12 minutes and 51 seconds. He wore number 64. But I think that he is really sort of the Lance Boma model from the past. He's that gritty, in-your-face, fourth-line player that we haven't seen here this year.
Yeah. And his hitting throughout the contest actually led to the Flames' second goal because it caused a turnover, which shortly thereafter went into the Flyers' net. And that helped to spark the attempted comeback with the goal 50 seconds later. So I like what he brought, and like I didn't necessarily agree with him getting promoted to the first line tonight, but his energy was much needed, and Calgary needs that kind of player on the team long term. Like, if he can bring that every night, I think he's locked up a spot.
I think if Hathaway can continue to play the way that he has in the back-to-back series this week against the Flyers and the Bruins, I think that there's going to be a guy who's going to be seriously challenging for one of the spots come training camp. And I think a guy who might make some of the other players worried, because I think a guy like Juris could easily lose a spot to Hathaway.
I agree fully.
I think, too, that Hathaway, from what we kind of saw, especially in the Philly game, is I think he's elevating a lot of other players. I think part of what was happening last season was nobody thought their job was safe. I mean, the Flames had no qualms about promoting some young guy and giving him your spot on the ice. And we haven't seen them do that so far this season. We haven't seen the Flames, you know, saying, okay, you're not playing well. I mean, look at how long Mason Raymond lasted before they sent him to the AHL. They threatened him with waivers once, didn't send him down, finally did it a second time and sent him down. But I think with Hathaway in the lineup, it looked like there were some guys who felt like maybe they had to prove that they should stay here.
Mm-hmm. And that's what gets you the best results, is if everybody's a little on the uncomfortable side, especially after trading Jones, who is one of the bottom six forwards, and seeing what he got in return, you know, like there's not a huge demand for any of those type of players now, it seems, in the NHL. So if you're not going to put up with us and, you know, bust your ass in each game, then you're going to be replaced by Hathaway or Klimchuk or Poirier or Shore or Agostino or Shinkarik or whatever. So, you know, having that fire under them should be something to motivate them moving forward.
Garnet Hathaway registered 3 hits in his first game, which is, you know, not too bad. He didn't seem out of place either. So often you'll see these guys who are playing their first ever NHL game, and they just seem like maybe the fame's got to them. Maybe it's like, oh, I'm finally here, and they're trying so hard not to mess up that they end up not being very effective. And I thought that in this game, Hathaway was able to keep his head in the game and not let it affect him that, hey, it's my first NHL game, I got to try not to screw up. He knew what he had to do. He came in, he did his job, and, you know, did it well.
And I think a large amount of credit has to go to Ryan Huska in Stockton, the head coach down there. Despite the team not being very good in the standings, all 3 of Hathaway, Nkladl, and Wotherspoon in their call-ups have stood out as being quite impressive.
For sure. Yeah, I think, you know, and we've seen Nkladl here for a while. We've seen Wotherspoon come up. This year he finally got to play. I mean, last year he got signed up or brought up and didn't get to play at all. I think after seeing Wotherspoon playing over the last little bit, I'm starting to have renewed faith in him. I really had sort of written him off after we got guys like Morrison and Shillington into the AHL team. But I think that Wotherspoon realizes too, probably like Hathaway does, that in a way he's playing for his life.
Yeah.
Because those guys were both further down the depth chart, and it's like, I'm getting a chance to show I should be up higher on the depth chart. Let's do it.
Oh, I know, and especially with Wotherspoon only having 4 assists this season after, I think, like 19 points a year ago, like, that's just not very good. So he needed to show that, like, numbers aren't everything, and I think in the games that he did play, he was quite effective.
For those that don't know a lot about Garnet Hathaway, he's a right winger, 6'4". 6'2", 208 pounds. He shoots right, and he's 24 years old. He was signed as a free agent by the Flames in 2014, so came to the team in a similar way that our captain, Mark Giordano, did as an undrafted free agent. He played university for Brown University, played there for 4 years, came and played 1 year in Abbotsford. Last year in Adirondack, he had 36 points in 72 games. So a guy, I think, a lot like Juris, and maybe that's why they brought him up, who signed as a free agent, has had some AHL success, and now they want to see what he can do at the next level.
Yeah. And the first time we saw Hathaway, like I recall saying that you could tell this guy's going to be a future NHL player just because of how determined he is out on the ice. And we saw that in his debut where he was all over the place.
So good for him. And I agree with you that I wouldn't have put him on the first line, but I think that with the Flames really not playing for anything in the Boston game, why not reward that hard work? Why not give him those shifts with, you know, with Monahan and with Goudreau and really kind of reward that good play?
Well, plus his family was all there because he's from Maine, and his family all drove down to the game. So I thought that was a nice thing for him on a side note.
Yeah, I mean, you could have put him on the first line, you know, let him take the opening faceoff and then relegated him after that. But why not? I mean, they're not playing for wins here.
No, they're playing for spots for next season,
exactly.
Realistically.
And if he's earning,
if wins come, hey, great. If not, well, we're nearly dead last anyway, so what difference does it make?
So while we're talking about the Boston game, why don't we officially introduce that one? The day after the trade deadline and the second of a back-to-back, the Flames put Joni Ordio back in the net as they have a new look to their roster coming into Boston, where they dropped a 2-1 game to the Bruins. Landon Ferraro scored in the first. I really thought it was going to be a 1-0 win for Boston. And then late in the third, Jakob Nekladl got his first ever NHL goal. First of the season, his first ever NHL goal. And that was assisted by Jyrki Jokipaka, one of the brand new Flames, and Michael Frolik. So good to see, I guess, two guys who needed a Flames point get one in this game.
Yeah, and I like the pairing of Nekladl and Jokipaka. Just for the fact that have fun announcers trying to cover the game.
we'll call this the mouthful pairing.
Yeah.
Nekladl and Jokipaka.
Yeah.
And if anyone watched Sportsnet tonight, Leah Hextall had problems pronouncing Jokipaka as well. And she just called him Kevin. I guess back in Dallas, he used to go to Starbucks, and they always write your name on a cup at Starbucks, and they couldn't pronounce his name. So he just said, just put Kevin on there. She said that's what she's going to call him.
Yeah. I'm calling the pairing the knack pack pairing.
Okay.
Just for simplicity.
Based on what we've seen from Nekladl now, do you think the Flames should offer him another deal?
Definitely. No reason. Anytime you have somebody that's as large as Nekladl, can play a little bit at both ends of the ice, why not see what he's got? And the Flames, if they... It's one of those situations. If the Flames get a clear upgrade on, like, the three spots past the top three guys, then maybe you don't sign Nekladl, but the odds of that happening when you have Weidman and England and Smead under contract, still, I'd keep him around just for... Because I think Nekladl's better than all three of those guys, actually, so...
And it's nice to see the European experiment working out. I mean, you know, if you remember a couple of years ago, what was the name of that Russian guy we brought in for one year?
Roman Chervenka.
Roman Chervenka didn't work out. I mean, they didn't even know what position the guy played. Last year we had Wolf, didn't really work out. And now we've got Nekladl as the, you know, the overage rookie brought in from Europe. And I'm glad to see it's working out for the Flames. I think Nekladl looks like an NHL defenseman, not, you know, a top three guy, but definitely a bottom three guy. And I would sign him. I might not keep him in the NHL next year, but why not sign him?
Yeah, and I'm not a huge fan of advanced statistics at all, but in the Corsi ratings, both Nekladl and Wotherspoon were quite excellent since they've joined the Flames. So at least that's an upgrade over the other four defensemen who, in that metric, were quite terrible. So,
looking at this game against the Boston Bruins, besides Nekladl getting his first career NHL point, any real highlights to me? I didn't see a lot of highlights in this
game.
That
was a boring, boring, boring game. Like, it was just, oh, you're there, you have the puck, I'm going to hit you. You've turned it over, I'm going to skate the other way. Oh no, I've been hit.
Neither team got a lot of shots. I mean, it was 25-25 at the end for shots.
Yeah, it was just, like, in the first period, I think the Flames had one scoring chance. Neither side was really doing much of anything. Like, I think after the first, like, 17 minutes in the first period, the shots were 4-4. And all of them except for the Ferraro shot were, like, distant point shots that were, like, easy saves for the goalies. So, yeah, just not a very stellar game for either side.
One last thing. I heard people saying, oh, the Flames did such a good job of keeping Boston only five shots in the first. And I'm wondering if it was the Flames really keeping Boston to that, or Boston just, I don't know, both teams seem like they weren't really into it.
Yeah.
If it was Boston just taking it easy on us.
I know, like, through the first, like, 39 minutes or something like that, Boston had eight shots, or eight or nine. Like, not the type of effort that you would expect from them.
I kind of wish the Flames had a couple days off now, because it seems like maybe they need a mental break, but they've only got one day off for their next game on Thursday.
Well, they're playing Buffalo, so that's kind of a day off.
I don't know. I mean, you got to remember, we're not a playoff team. This, you know, Buffalo is in about our caliber if you look at the standings.
Oh, I know.
And last time we played Buffalo, it was a 4-3 win, so it's not like it was an easy win against them.
True.
Well, Matt, why don't we move on to what everyone wants to hear us talk about, and that was trade deadline 2016. I was really surprised. I felt bad for the guys in TSN and Sportsnet because there was no trading happening. Like, these guys were sitting around for their 8-hour, 9-hour shift, whatever it was, and for most of the morning, there was really no trade that happened. And
yeah,
you could tell
Sergei Plotnikov became an international superstar.
Pretty much.
For like 4 hours, and then we'll never be heard from again.
You could tell that they were getting bored, because I was watching some of the Sportsnet coverage and they were trading commentators.
Yeah.
They had a group that was upstairs and a group that was downstairs, and they ended up having two former GMs trade guys among them. And I'm like, wow, we're desperate.
Yeah. Or TSN had Martin Baron fire a t-shirt cannon at Jennifer Hedger.
Yeah, I saw that too. So you've got to wonder what intern had to run out and get a t-shirt cannon, because we got nothing going on.
Yeah, that was strange, but it is what it is.
Well, let's talk about what the Flames did. The first deal that the Flames did that we didn't cover, the last one that you and I talked about, was the Granlund deal. And since then, the Flames made one move early. They got a jump on the deadline, sending Jari Hudler to the Florida Panthers, and in exchange received Florida's 2016 second-round pick and their 2018 fourth-round pick. Why don't you go first and give us some of your thoughts on this deal, Matt? Do you think the Flames got enough?
And my initial reaction was, that's not quite a good return. And then the rest of the deadline happened, and I'm like, yeah, that wasn't actually that bad of a return. With all of the other players that were available, I think that was pretty much what this year's market value was. Like, I know intrinsically you look at what Glenn Cross got us last year in a deeper draft, but with the financial situation around the league, possible expansion, and just general questions about what everything is going to be like next year and beyond, I think teams are a little bit more hesitant to do anything.
Yeah, I thought at first it was a little bit weak. I thought, come on, we could have done better than that. We could have got a first. But you're right, after looking at the deadline, after the trade deadline was over and what did and didn't happen, I think the Flames obviously knew that we're not going to get better. It's not worth waiting for the deadline. We've got a decent deal. Let's take it. And you and I were talking last week. My prediction was that Hudler would go for a first and a prospect. And really, I mean, that fourth-round pick can still turn into a decent prospect. If you look at the guys that the Flames have been drafting in round four lately, I still think that second and fourth are going to net big pieces for this rebuild.
Yeah. Well, any picks are always a good thing, especially when it comes to our scouting staff. They've been able to find some really good players over the last few years, since 2010, 2011. So just have to wait and see what the Flames do with their four picks in the top two rounds. this year, and yeah.
You're also a Panthers fan. You're a Flames and a Panthers fan. What does this mean for the Panthers to bring in a player like this?
It's huge, and having him, he's playing on the first line with Jágr, which is kind of expected, and they needed another good quality scoring forward. They've been having some injury troubles off and on all year, so especially going into the stretch drive, they're tied with Tampa Bay with a game in hand for the division lead. And they're only, I think, 4 points up on Boston for a wild card spot. So their situation, even in their own division, isn't assured. So getting a good reinforcement in Hudler will help them to cement their division title.
I still think we may see Hudler back in Calgary come July.
It would depend largely on what the other free agents do and how much money's available, really.
Yeah, I can't see him getting what he wants, which sounds like it's north of $4 million a year. I think with the salary cap standing pat, there's not going to be a lot of money to go around. I don't think Hudler's going to make enough playoff impact that someone's going to feel they need to pay that. I don't think he'll come back July 1st.
No.
But I can see fielding offers saying, I'm really not getting the offers I want. Here's an offer from Calgary. You know, I know them. Let's go back there.
Yeah, because I'm thinking that he would be looking at what Cammalleri got as, like, the baseline, which was a 5-5 deal. So, like, he'd probably be wanting north of that in the 5.5 to 6 range, which is understandable. You know, he's roughly the same age as what Cammalleri was when he left for New Jersey. But I don't see the Flames signing him to more than a 2-year deal if they do sign him in the offseason.
Yeah,
just
I think,
have to wait and see.
I think 2 years for about $2 million would probably be where.
No, I could even see the $4 million. He was worth full value.
It's going to depend who else they bring in, though. I mean, you know, if they bring in, as you've talked about, a guy like an Okposo, I think that Hudler now becomes a 2-3 forward, not worth $4 million.
Yeah. Well, for me, there's three main targets for the right wing position on UFA day: Troy Brouwer, David Backes, and Kyle Okposo. So if the Flames fail to get more than one or any of them, then Hudler becomes a decent secondary option. But I don't think that would be your number one choice.
No, I don't think so. But, you know, I hope that Jari has success in Florida. I hope that they can go far. It would be kind of interesting to see Hudler versus Russell in the Stanley Cup Finals.
Yeah.
And that leads us to our second deal. I think probably undoubtedly the biggest deal as far as what it means to both teams and the package that Calgary got back. I think probably the biggest and most interesting trade of the deadline. Would you agree?
Yeah. And quite bizarre how the Flames were able to get that kind of a return.
And you had mentioned Jari Jokapacka from Dallas as a player you wanted to bring back potentially in the past. I didn't think it would actually happen.
No, neither did I. And like, if it was like Russell moving, I would have thought that would have been like a 1-for-1 plus like a 5th-round pick or something like that. So to get him and 2 second-round picks, one a former drafted player and one in the 2016 draft, that was huge for this team moving forward.
Well, let's talk about the official deal. Chris Russell moved from the Calgary Flames to the Dallas Stars. Russell will wear number 3 with the Dallas Stars now. And in return, we get Jari Jokapacka, who's an NHL-caliber defenseman. We get Brett Pollock, who was a second-round pick in 2014 for Dallas, a prospect with the organization, and a guaranteed at least second-round pick. And this has got to be the weirdest condition I've ever heard on a draft pick. If Dallas reaches the conference finals this year and Russell plays 50% of the games in round 1 and 2, then the pick gets converted to a first-round pick this year for the Flames. Otherwise, it remains a second-round pick.
And if that does happen, Burke has to wear a Dallas Stars jersey in his next media appearance.
If they get the first?
Yes.
Don't you think it's a weird condition? Like, often it's, you know, oh, we just made the conference finals. There's your pick. But,
well, Dallas is deep with defensemen, so they're probably hedging. Like, if Dallas comes there, or Russell comes there and is terrible and sucks, and he's just a passenger on their way to the conference finals, then they don't want the Flames getting rewarded for that.
That's a good way to look at it.
But apparently in his Stars debut, he was quite impressive, and that's a good thing, because you don't want to see a team getting ripped off.
No, you sure don't, especially when you send a guy like Russell somewhere. I mean, Russell's a good defenseman. You know, he's going to a team where he has a chance to win a cup. I really hope that I hope for the Flames' sake that he plays a lot of games and they go to the conference finals.
Yeah.
And
it's going to be tough for Dallas, because they have to figure out a way to beat the juggernaut in their division, the Chicago Blackhawks. But stranger things have happened, so we'll see.
And then I thought the Flames would be done for the day there, but right after the deadline it was announced, and I guess there was a holdup because of a no-trade clause, which we'll talk about, but the Flames also sent their last UFA, David Jones, to the Minnesota Wild in exchange for a sixth-round draft pick. I believe that's this year's sixth-round pick.
Yes, it is.
And goaltender Nicklas Backstrom, who has not played hockey in over a year, and I guess the delay on this was that Backstrom has a no-trade clause that he had to waive. So, you know, when I saw the return from Dallas, I was expecting, honestly, that Jones was leaving as well. Like, when I saw what the Flames got back, a young prospect, a defenseman who has NHL experience and at least a second-round pick, I thought, okay, the trade's just still breaking.
I was expecting, like, Colborne or something notable going their way as well, but...
And then apparently Dallas made a similar offer to Vancouver for Hamuse.
Yeah, well, what happened there was the management for Vancouver took it to ownership, and the ownership said, oh, we want more than that, and they took that back to Dallas, and they accepted the deal with Russell, and that was that. So, yeah.
I don't really know. Well, we'll talk a little bit about it a bit later, but the Jones deal, I guess it's good that we got an asset for him, but I was expecting him to go for more than that.
Yeah. Well, you also have to put that in context of what the deadline was all about, and none of the players that were depth guys were getting anything in return. And, like, you saw guys like Verbata and P.A. Parenteau, they didn't even get dealt.
Yeah, no, that's true. I guess the issue I have with this deal was, and we heard Burke say it on deadline day, and we heard him saying it leading up to it, of reminding the media how a couple of years ago we didn't trade Cammalleri on the deadline because he didn't get any good offers, and how he wanted to make a point that the Flames don't give guys away, and you can't just call us the deadline and expect to have somebody given away. And you know me, I've been very critical of him since for not at least getting a sixth or a seventh, like get some value for him. And I feel like trading David Jones at the deadline for a goaltender who's probably got no future here and a sixth-round pick, we're doing just what we finished touting ourselves that we don't do, that we don't give guys away. I think David Jones would have been, to get a sixth-round pick, I would have almost kept Jones and said, hey, you know, we can either scratch him for the season, or we've got him as that you know, veteran guy to bring some guys up from the farm. But I almost feel like it's a bit hypocritical of Burke to have been promoting all morning how we don't give players away, and then we give Jones away.
Well, I don't see that really as giving him away. Like, that's if Backstrom was not going to play at all, then I would be slightly more deferential to your way of thinking. It's just with Backstrom,
let's be honest, the only reason we got Backstrom back is they need to clear salary.
Yeah, not necessarily. He is an unrestricted free agent at the end of the year, and why not test out one of the UFA goaltenders? You got nothing but time on your hands for a month and a half. play them in a couple of games. If you like what you see, maybe you invite them to training camp next year, or you sign them as a backup.
Yeah, I know. He's 38. I think that his body of work is well known out there.
I know, but he hasn't played all year and sparsely throughout.
Okay, but if you want Backstrom, you probably could have got him for a seventh. Like, I think really, I don't look at this as Jones for Backstrom. I look at this as Jones for a sixth and clearing. I think it's clearing a contract space, and Trelivian's even alluded to that. So, I don't know. I think that this is no different than the Cammalleri thing, and I don't know why we're giving Jones away. Yes, the Flames have done well with sixth-round picks the last couple of years. I think, you know, Olas Mattsson is a sixth-round pick is the exception rather than the rule there, who will turn out to be a good player, but I don't see that sixth-round pick doing a lot for us, either as a tradable asset or a player in the system.
Well, Jones was a UFA at the end of the year, and there's no way that the Flames were going to bring him back. So,
I don't think they'll bring back Backstrom either.
No, neither do I. But yeah, as you said, with the Cammalleri trade, it's better to get something than nothing.
And I agree with you on that respect, but I think it goes against what Burke had been promoting all morning, which is we don't trade guys for little return, right? We're only going to trade guys. That's my problem with this, not the sixth round pick. I honestly think that if we look at it as an isolated incident, the Flames were in a good spot and they moved him and they got something. That's important. I don't disagree with that. But when we look at it that all morning and in interviews leading up to the deadline, we had Burke promoting how, oh, we don't give guys away. You know, we didn't give Cammalleri away because we didn't get the return we wanted. And I remember telling Burke at an event a couple years ago, I would have taken a sixth or seventh for Cammy. And people laughed at me and they said, well, don't do that. And I said, at least we got an asset. So in isolation, I agree. The Jones deal doesn't look bad for the Flames, but why was our stance 2 years ago that we don't give guys away? And up until the deadline, that's our stance. And then all of a sudden we give a guy away. I think you kind of have to practice what you preach.
Yeah. The way I look at Jones is that he's just an average fourth liner. So a sixth-round pick isn't really that out of line. Probably could have got more like a fifth or a fourth, but I don't know. I don't see that being that much of a huge drop-off.
We'll see. I guess it's just, it was that, what well, I look at is the hypocritical behavior that really bothered me.
Yeah.
I'm not saying the return for Jones wasn't good. I think it's good in this situation with nobody moving, but I would have been much happier if the Flames said, you know what, we're following our own rules. We're following the rule we established 2 years ago. We don't give guys away. We had an offer for Jones for a late round pick, and we said no.
Can't argue with you. So we'll see. Like how this impacts the team moving forward next year, if that has any impact whatsoever.
I'm not saying that Jones and Cammalleri are the same player by any stretch. Yes, Cammalleri is more valuable probably on the trade market. But I guess to me it's just that, and if Burke hadn't mentioned anything, that would be different too. But Burke had spent all his time leading up to trade deadline promoting this, and then we didn't do it.
Yeah.
So that to me is what's rubbing me the wrong way. But with that off my chest, why don't we get to know some of the new Flames, some of the guys that are now here in the organization? I think now the Flame with the best name on the roster, Jyrki Joukkopäkka. His cap hit is $900,000. This guy's a big 24-year-old defenseman, 24-year-old defenseman wearing number 3 for the Flames. He's played in Dallas's system for a few years. He played in Texas since 2013-2014. He's played in the NHL last couple of years. Not a guy I'd look at this point as a top 3 defenseman. I don't know what you think. He's a 7th-round pick. So I guess right there you could say, well, if he's a 7th-round pick, maybe we can get some for Jones's 6th, but we'll see. Not a guy I would look at as a top 3 guy yet, but a guy that I think could end up being maybe the Hamilton partner in a couple of years is sort of that, you know, number 4 guy.
He played well tonight against Boston. Was physical at times, only made one reckless mistake. Other than that, he was solid, got an assist. Not bad.
He's a stay-at-home defenseman. I think that's going to be different for a lot of Flames fans. We're used to having some really offensive defensemen on our blue line, and I think that that's going to be the big compliment there, is he's not going to put up the points that Brody does or Giordano does, but I think we have to appreciate what he can do defensively.
Yeah, and one of the things that the team has been preaching for the last couple of seasons is getting bigger. And now the Flames, with moving out Russell and Hudler, only have Gaudreau as a player that's under 6 feet tall.
The only one who can't go on the roller coaster.
Exactly. Everybody else can have fun but him. But now with Nikladl being like 6'2", 6'3", Joki Paki being 6'3", it just helps bring size to the back end, especially when the Flames go up against teams like Anaheim, LA, San Jose, even to a lesser extent Winnipeg. All teams that have really big players physically, they're not going to get pushed around as easily in their own zone.
Yeah, for sure. And I think that it's getting bigger is good. I also think that the number was right on Joki Paakkinen. I mean, if you look, he's making $900,000 this year. He's making $900,000 next year. If you're looking at a guy like Derek England, who's making almost $3 million in the same spot on the roster, I think that this really sets a new precedent for a guy like Nikladl to re-sign, to say, okay, you know, you're in the same range as Joki Paakkinen as far as, you know, your roster spot. So that's where we'll re-sign you to.
Yeah.
And it's going to free up a ton of money there for the Flames to sign their big two forwards.
And especially next year when guys like Englund, Smead, Raymond, and Weidman's contracts all expire, you can have guys coming up like Joki Paakkinen, like Nikladl, like Wotherspoon, like Kulak, that can all be cheap bargain contracts while playing at an NHL level. Now, you're not necessarily going to have all of those players in the NHL at the same time, but cheap options help allow the team to go out and, say, spend $7 million on a Kyle Okposo or something like that, instead of having that money tied up in fourth line guys.
And I believe, not saying they would do it, but I believe Joki Paakkinen is still waiver exempt.
Could be.
I'd have to look into it, but I'm pretty sure he's still waiver exempt, which would mean that if they wanted to, they wouldn't have to carry him. They'll carry him for the rest of the year. There's no reason not to. But they might say, you know what, let's put this guy back and make him the best defenseman in the AHL if they think he needs some seasoning, or if somebody jumps over him in the depth chart.
Yeah.
Well, I can't see them doing anybody, it, but it gives them some options.
Yeah, I think if anybody jumps over him in the depth chart, I think that you'd likely move away from him anyway. But we'll see.
Along with Joki Paakkinen, the other guy that came back from the Dallas Stars is a centerman, a left-handed shooter who's 19 years old. He was drafted in the second round, the 45th pick in 2014 by the Stars, and it's Brett Pollock, a guy who plays for the Edmonton Oil Kings in the WHL, so a lot of Calgary fans have seen him play here, and a guy who's having a good offensive production in the WHL. If you look, he's played there really since 2012-2013. He had a bad first year. He got 4 points in 40 games. 2013-2014, he had 55 points in 71 games. Last year, he did 62 points in 70 games. This year, he's doing better in point per game so far. He's at 67 points in 64 games. And a guy who I think, you know, a big guy, 6'2", 185 pounds. I think a guy who's not ready to come into the NHL yet, but his size and his scoring skills at that level suggest he could be an effective power forward, and he gives us that long-term player, another piece for 2-3 years down the road.
Yeah, and he's got a very good stick when it comes to shooting on the net. Quick hands, can pick the corners. I remember in his draft year that I had actually rated him as one of the players that I wanted the Flames to use a second round pick on, when instead of guys like McDonald and Hunter Smith, from one of those two picks. So decent all around player. He's another in that same grouping in my mind as Poirier, Klimchuk, and Shinkarik. So, middle six talented wingers. He can also slot in as a left winger instead of a center. So, we'll see.
He's a guy who I think has, you know, been lucky in Edmonton in some ways. He attended his first training camp last year, got sent back to the WHL, and after the Oil King won the Memorial Cup in 2014, he really got a bigger role last year and this year on Edmonton. He was kind of the next guy in line, so he got a lot more minutes there, and I think that's really helped him. But from what I've seen and what I've read about this guy, he needs to improve his consistency, and he needs to work on his skating a bit. But as a 19-year-old, I'm not too worried about that.
Yeah, and I think you can pretty much list those two things as something every 18, 19-year-old has to work on.
So I wouldn't be... He's signed for this year and two more at $750,000. So they have him under contract till the end of the 17-18 season. I would not be in any rush to move him to the AHL. I think that the Flames have enough forward depth there that Pollock might get lost. I would say he's probably best with the production he's having to send him back to the Dub for his overage year.
I think you might see him getting bumped up just to...
It's going to depend on who might get promoted to the NHL, but if we look at the WHL or the AHL roster right now, I don't think that he'd probably get the minutes you'd want.
True.
So, yeah, I mean, if a guy like, Poirier or Arnold or Shinkarik get moved up to the NHL next year, then, yeah, I think there's a good spot for him.
Lots of things that have to be figured out in training camp.
But I'm excited to see Pollock come to camp. I think the Flames got not necessarily, a top three prospect, but I'd say probably quite a good prospect here. A guy I think would be, like you said, sort of that second level of prospect. A guy who's definitely going to make the NHL and probably play in the NHL for a while, but not your guy who's going to be your top three forward.
Yeah, like a similar caliber of guy as like a guy like Cody Eakin from Dallas. A decent secondary player, not going to blow you away, just does his job, and that's that.
And the last player the Flames brought in, a guy who's familiar to Flames fans from our former interdivision rivalry, Nicklas Backstrom. And different reading this guy. He's making $3.5 million this year, so we're bringing in less than Jones is making, but still a significant contract. He hasn't played hockey in over a year, and he's 38 years old. 6'2" and 187 6'2", 194 pounds. So we're getting big even in the net. And it's interesting because he hasn't played hockey since January of 2015, and Hartley has said that he will get at least one start here with the Flames wearing number 32. Looking at the Nicklas Backstrom acquisition, what do you think about the Flames bringing this piece back, Matt?
Why not try? The Flames
can't be worse
need-
than Hiller.
The Flames need a goaltender for next year, likely two guys. And, if Ordio struggles down the stretch, they're likely not going to bring him back, even though he's had a couple of good games. So, if that's the case, then you have to figure out who your starter and your backup are going to be. The Flames are not likely going to bring back Hiller or Ramo, especially with Ramo's injury troubles, because the recovery time's pretty much in training camp when he'll be first starting to skate again. So having a test run with the UFA goaltender, if he stinks, you just move on. Okay, we tried that, didn't work, next. If he does impress, then perhaps a training camp invite or signing him as a backup, as a fallback option. Just have to wait and see.
I think this, to me, reads a lot like when the Flames brought in Curtis Joseph with Kiprusov. I think he's being brought in as the mentor for Joni Ordio. And I think that he's kind of here to impart his knowledge on the young goalie while he's here. I can see him coming to training camp next year. I can't see the Flames signing him unless he's willing to go to the AHL.
If he was basically willing to do the Joey McDonald type of, you know, play anywhere whenever it's necessary type role, that might be the case.
That could work, and I could see him going to the AHL. And I said at the beginning of the year, I would like the Flames to sign a veteran goaltender to be the AHL backup to help Gillies at the time, you know, and be that mentor. And I could see him in that role, being that old mentor, sort of like Cujo was here. But I'd see it at the AHL level, because I don't think that we have that young goaltender needs at the NHL level here. So yeah, if he just wants to play hockey and the Flames are willing to give him, you know, $1.5 million to play in the A, I don't see a downside to it. He can't be worse than Hiller. If it were me, I would dress him over Hiller for the rest of the year, even as a backup, just see what we've got
same
there.
Here. Same here.
I would pretty much tell Hiller, pack up the pads and head home. But yeah, I think that you can't get worse than Hiller. I don't see him coming back next year, and I don't see him playing the rest of the games. I think it's Ordeo's net to lose from here on out.
Yeah, I don't think you'll see Backstrom in more than, say, five games.
Unless he needs to play relief a lot, in which case something's gone wrong with Ordeo.
Yeah, well then the whole net situation's a disaster, and yeah, that's a whole different thing.
I mean, the thing with Ordeo is we don't really know still what we've got there. Last year he looked good. This year he's looking okay. With Backstrom, we know what we've got. I mean, he's been around the league forever. And I think the Flames are going to be hesitant to bring a guy like that back, too, after their last broken goalie, if you will. You know, we brought in Hiller, who'd had a bad season, didn't play a lot. We thought maybe we could revive him, and that didn't work. And I think the Flames, of all teams, might shy away from Backlund or Backstrom just because of that, after being burned by Hiller.
Yeah, could very well be. But doesn't hurt. You know, if he struggles and loses a game, is it really going to matter one way or the other?
Not this year, but but next year, bringing him back.
I know. Well, that's why you test him out now to see where he's at.
And, I mean, he hasn't even been hurt. He just he hasn't played in over a year.
Yeah.
Which isn't
when you have Darcy Kemper and Devin Dubnyk, you don't really need a third goaltender, so it is what it is. You kind of get lost in the shuffle.
Yeah, I'm just surprised that, and maybe no one's offered for him, but I'm surprised he hasn't waived a no movement to go somewhere like in Edmonton earlier.
Well, getting paid $4 million for being a 3+ goals against average goaltender in the last 40-some-odd games that he's played. No, there's not really going to be too many suitors for that.
Yeah, I guess it depends how badly you want to play hockey.
True.
And then Backstrom will be wearing 32 when he does make his way into the Flames net. And the other new addition to the team, who we talked a little bit about earlier, wearing number 64, was Garnet Hathaway. And he's played 2 games now. Matt, why do you think they chose to call Hathaway up? He's not the guy that I would have given the call to if I was the GM.
Well, the likeliest people that would have got recalled were Agostino and Freddie Hamilton. And I think the reason why they weren't recalled was due to their age. And I think that both of them would have had to go through waivers to get sent back down, where Hathaway can get sent down at any point.
If I remember correctly, Hathaway counts as one of our 4 post-deadline recalls. He's not an emergency.
Yeah, well, that's so he can play in the AHL playoffs.
Yeah, and same thing happened with Wotherspoon and Ordeo, too. They were essentially sent down and then brought back up, so they're eligible to play in the playoffs if Stockton can make it.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I don't know. It's interesting for Wotherspoon. I mean, even a guy like, you know, those other two you're talking about, I probably would have, if I was the GM, have even brought up Hunter Shinkarak.
He still might. We still have got 19 games left to go, so I'm sure you'll see quite a few players down the road, like towards the end of the season. Because you remember last year in that last game against Winnipeg, how we had phantom injuries to a bunch of guys and had Ramage come up and play.
I stubbed my toe.
Yeah, basically, oh, I can't time my skate because I stubbed my toe.
It's a season-ending injury on the last game of the season.
Yep.
I am glad, though. I mean, you know, Hathaway, it looks like a good move. That's why Treliving's the GM and not me. But I'm just glad they didn't reach for Mason Raymond. I was kind of expecting that to be the next call-up, honestly. He's looked not too bad at the AHL level. But I think it's sending a message to the Flames team, both NHL and AHL, when you don't just reach for Raymond and bring him back up.
Yeah, I think Raymond's done for this season at least.
Yeah, they're not going to shut him down. They'll just keep him at the AHL level. And, and I think he could be valuable going forward if they can make the playoffs.
True.
But yeah, I was just glad. I don't think we'll see him back in a Flaming Sea this year. I think he comes to camp. He'll probably, you know, try his hardest in camp that he's tried since his rookie year. But I think, I honestly think that Raymond's done as a Calgary Flame.
So do I.
And then we talked about Wotherspoon. Wotherspoon was up here. He was before replacing Chris Russell, so he was seen as emergency recall. But the Flames sent him back down to the AHL because they got Joki Paakka up. He was no longer an emergency. Also because they wanted to be eligible for the AHL playoffs, now they've brought him up. So they cannot keep Wotherspoon in the NHL and not burn one of their recalls. They only get four. So if they bring him up in Hathaway, that would be two. Do you think we see Wotherspoon come back up, or do you think now that Joki Paakka's here, they will keep him down?
I think what you're going to see with the Flames, they have 12 forwards, 6 defensemen, and now 2 goalies on the roster. So if any injuries happen, they will count as the emergencies. So I think you won't see Wotherspoon back unless somebody else gets hurt.
And do you think the Flames might start shutting guys down who are playing with injuries?
Possibly.
You know,
it depends what, who and what. Like, Ladislav Smead, I think he's done for the year. You know, outside of that, it would just depend on what.
I can't see
who.
Them shutting down a top guy, but if we found out that someone like Matt Stajan has been playing with an injury, or Frolik still wasn't 100%, I could see them maybe shutting the guy down and saying, you know what, we'll bring somebody else in to replace you.
Pretty much.
Especially because those guys have some tenure here and you don't want to hurt them, you know, and then they're not as valuable next year. So, you know, even a guy like Josh Juris, I think they might shut down for the year, not because of an injury, just because, you know what, we need to try somebody else in that role. And what do you think the Flames are going to do with goaltenders going forward, Matt? Right now they're carrying Hiller and Ordeo, but we saw that Backstrom joined the team today. Do you think that they will send Ordeo down to the AHL and carry a Hiller-Backstrom pairing?
Well, technically they have to send Ordeo down once Backstrom like officially joins the team and is on the roster. Even if they immediately want to recall him, they still have to send him down.
Yeah, paperwork-wise, they have to. But do you think we will see Ordeo continue to wear a Flaming C this year?
More than likely. More than 50-50 chance. I don't see the Flames unless Ordeo is terrible in like the next couple of chances, if he does get any more, then I could see them just saying, we're good with just running with Backstrom, but I don't see that. I think Ordeo will be recalled and will remain in net for the majority.
It's interesting because if you look at the beginning of the season, we started with 3 goaltenders, and I think we're going to bookend the season on the other side with 3 different goaltenders, but 3 goaltenders nonetheless.
Yeah.
So you were...
Not the ideal situation, but it is what it is.
You were the guy who at the beginning of the season was wanting every show for the Flames to have dealt with the goalie situation, and I think now we're almost at peace with it that... Okay, you know what? It's not ideal, but it really doesn't matter how many goalies we have. We could have 3 or 9 or 40. It doesn't really matter. I think it's Ordeo's net from here on in unless he loses it.
And with there not really being any consequences to having a bad game in terms of, you know, playoff implications, it allows some freedom to allow a goaltender to work through some issues as well. So like if Ordeo struggles, like, say against the Sabres on Thursday, assuming he plays, then, you know, you could let him go again either in the next game or the one after and try to figure out how to take those next steps for the next level for next year.
And Treliving told the media on deadline day that they really want to continue to see what they have in Joni. So to me, that tells me that there might be some interest there in bringing him back next year. You know, he is an RFA. He can be re-signed. I don't think anyone would offer sheet him. But, you know, he could still, I still think he could be a decent backup. We just got to figure out the inconsistency with him. That's the big problem. Like, why was he terrible for so much of the year?
I know. And I think Ordeo's problem is almost entirely between his ears. Like, he's fundamentally is a fairly decent goaltender. The only critique is that when he does go down, he crouches down a little too much, making him too small in the net. Other than that, most of his stylistic performance is good. And like we've seen in three of the four games he played this week, he was fairly solid at making saves and secondary saves. So we'll see. And who knows why he struggled all year. Like, this was not what we've seen this week is not the same goaltender I've watched all year in Stockton. What he was at the beginning of the season in Calgary was how he was playing in Stockton, and he was not very good. So,
and I've been the first one to point out in the past, I mean, a couple of years ago, he started in the ECHL and worked his way back to the NHL, but usually took him a month or so to get himself in order. Here it seemed to have taken three quarters of the season.
Yeah, and you can't really rely on a goaltender if he's even going to take three or four games to get underway. You pretty much, like, as soon as the puck drops in preseason, he needs to be ready to go.
Well, especially if he's being the backup. I mean, he has to be ready to go when he gets the nod. You can't say, okay, he's a backup, but he needs 20 games to get warmed up.
True.
See, this isn't baseball. They don't get pitchers in the bullpen to get warmed up. This guy's got to be ready to go.
Yeah.
And that might be the biggest reason that the Flames don't bring him back.
Yeah, we'll see. The last 20 games for him are the important ones to determine whether or not he's going to have an NHL contract or if he's going to head back to Europe next year.
Yeah, I think the Flames will retain his rights even if he goes to Europe. There's no reason not to. We don't need the, you know, the roster spot against our 50 right now. But yeah, I think this is going to determine if he's, you know, staying in North America, if he packs up his car and flies over, well, I guess not his car, but packs stuff up and flies back to Europe on July 1st. Couple other Flames, former Flames that moved, and I know you found this ironic. The Oilers claimed two former Flames off waivers, both Adam Party and Adam Cracknell going to Edmonton. So it seems like they're getting a lot of Flames leftovers up north.
Well, they see that we are actually able to develop late round picks and turn them into players, so they want to see how we did that.
Maybe they should bring some of our scouts in.
Yeah.
Also, former.
Well, actually, I do have to give them credit on one player, Brandon Davidson, an actual late round pick of theirs that has somewhat turned into a good prospect for them on defense. He did get re-signed this week, so
they got to do something right eventually.
Yeah, you got to figure if you're throwing that dart at the board, eventually you'll hit it once.
And also former Flame Alex Tanguay got dealt at the deadline from Colorado to the Coyotes in the Michael Bodker deal. Matt, looking at the deadline outside of the Flames, we've talked about the Flames overall. I think we can all admit this was a weaker deadline than we expected, not as many deals. Any big winners or losers for you?
The biggest winner, I actually have to say, is the Calgary Flames. Not being partisan because it's our team, but objectively, for what the Flames needed to accomplish, I think they did the best. Chicago would also be right there. They went out, they got what they needed.
And I think Chicago should get credit for shopping early, too.
Yeah.
Because I think they would have given up a lot more on the deadline day.
Yeah, well, just like Treliving selling Hudler early instead of potentially not being able to sell him on deadline day. That proved to actually be the correct move. So, it's interesting. For me, the biggest loser by far, without question, the Vancouver Canucks. When you have six UFAs and you don't make a trade, and in fact lose a player on waivers and don't get anything for them, yeah, it'd be one thing if Vancouver was a playoff team and vying for the Stanley Cup, but they're only, I think, 4 points ahead of us. So they're not going to make the playoffs. They needed to sell off, and they didn't do a damn thing.
For me, the winners and losers, I think that in the East, Toronto did a good job of selling. They needed some picks, and they were able to acquire some. I think Colorado has strengthened themselves for the playoffs, bringing in Michael Bodker and Eric Jelena. I think the deal that they made for Bodker was a fair deal, and I think that's going to help them out a lot. I agree that Chicago, I mean, they already looked like a Stanley Cup team, and it's interesting to see how a team like that can manipulate within the confines of the 23-man roster limit and the salary cap and still get better. And I think Andrew Ladd is going to look really good there. No doubt, I think the Flames won the deadline day. Edmonton, I think, is a big loser because they only moved Schultz and they got a dismal third rounder for Schultz. I think the Oilers needed to sell a lot more.
They did sell Purcell and Larson as well.
Yeah, for that's picks. True. But,
it's something. They're not going to sell Yakupov or any of the other big-name guys.
I think that not needing to do it for the playoffs, you're going to see one of those guys move at the NHL entry draft.
Oh, guaranteed.
I mean, Chiarelli needs to make a move, and really a lot of the bigger hockey moves are now being made at the draft. If you look over the past couple of years, salary cap moves are being made at the deadline, and hockey deals are being made at the draft.
Yeah. Well, I fully expect Travis Hamonic to become an Oiler at the draft table due to, like, say, Nugent Hopkins or Eberle getting dealt the other way.
I think you're right that the Canucks are a big loser at the deadline. They need to do something, and it's almost like they don't realize what they need to do. Like, they're so used to being in a playoff position, it's like they didn't realize, oh, we got to sell these guys?
Well, their management seems to be hamstrung a bit by the ownership group there, and they don't want to rebuild the owners, which is understandable because each of the time that they did actually rebuild, the building evacuated and they got like 10 to 12,000 fans for years and years. So,
well, I think it's interesting, too, that owners are meddling there because they brought in the Calgary Flames model and they brought Linden in to be the president of hockey ops, but it seems like he's not, in fact, running hockey operations. He still has somebody above him calling the shots.
Yeah. Realistically, they need to rebuild because the Sedins can only go on for so long, and I think they have like 3 or 4 years of usable game left in them. And you're going to need to hand that baton off to somebody else. And they've got nobody else.
Vancouver's trying to do this weird rebuilding in place thing of keep our big pieces and rebuild around them. And it's time to just admit, okay, it's time to rip this thing down and, rebuild it.
Yeah, like they got Emerson Edom, an okay fourth liner. They got Berchi, who's a second, third line guy. Not decent, not bad. They got Granlund, same as Berchi, not bad, not, going to blow you away. And they just, like, even their draft picks, like, Vertanen is not looking very good. Horvat's having a terrible season. I think he's, like, minus 35 or something like that. One of the worst in the league. McCann, he's all right, but limited upside. And then they've got Brock Besser, and that's it. So, when the Sedins do leave Vancouver, either through trade or retirement, they're going to suck for a long time. They might even rival Edmonton for duration of being losers.
Could be. Yeah, I think that they really need better... They really need better management there. I think that Linden might be the right guy, but I don't think he's the right guy for the president of hockey ops. I think he's the guy that needs to be the GM there, because I think he has the hockey smarts, and I don't think Benning's the right guy for a rebuild.
No. Honestly, if it was me, Benning should not have a job anymore, but we'll see. I put it this way, I think he's like number one on the list for off-season terminations, whether you're a coach or a general manager.
I think the other big deal that you were just talking, I'm just thinking about Vancouver and deals that might happen. I think another big deal that's going to happen at the draft table is the Jonathan Drouin trade.
Yeah.
I
can understand why Yzerman held off at the deadline with all the price tags being so severely depressed. If you're trying to maximize your return, that's not the time to do it.
Yeah, I think, too, that it also sort of says that the players are in charge. You know, if he says, well, I want to be traded, and you trade him at the deadline, I think in some ways it's saying, you know, hey, you can call the shots. And I think by Yzerman not trading him, it's kind of saying, I'm going to do this on my terms because I'm in charge.
True enough.
So I think that's the biggest reason. I mean, they don't need to trade him. He's not a distraction. He's at home. And as long as they're willing to pay him to sit at home, I don't think there's any rush to trade him. And I think as we get near the draft, especially, there's going to be some team who didn't get the guy they wanted, and they say, well, if we can't get that guy, let's go out and pay for Drouin.
Yeah, and it may be possible that Tampa, say, like, there's a team like Vancouver. Say Vancouver ends up with, like, the 9th overall pick. I could see Vancouver trading the 9th overall pick for Drouin.
Yeah, that's why I brought Drouin up there, because I was just thinking in my head, I could see him becoming a Canuck.
Yeah, so could I. And that would make some sense for what Vancouver's trying to do. I don't see, like, if Vancouver's, say, picking 5th, I don't see them doing that. But 9th or 10th, why not?
Yeah.
It'll be interesting.
Yeah, for sure. Anything else you want to talk about this week before we look ahead to the coming week for the Flames?
Glad that the Flames now have 5 picks in the top 70-ish, depending on where where we finish up and where that third round pick will end up being for us. This draft is not as talented as last year's, which is, you know, there's only been maybe 3 drafts in the last 20 years that have been as good as 2015. So even though they're the quality of players, you're not going to get the same talented guys as Anderson or Shillington in the second round, but the more opportunities you have to pick, the more of a chance that you'll get somebody good.
So looking at the draft picks the Flames have right now, as it sits, we have our first round pick. We have 3 picks in the second round, Florida's, Dallas's, and ours. Dallas's could become a first round pick. We have 1 third round pick, which is ours. We have 2 fourth round picks. 1 is ours and 1 is Nashville's. That was for the Max Reinhardt deal. And that one
may not exist.
That's
depending
conditional
on the condition.
Reinhardt has to play an undisclosed number of NHL games in the regular season and the playoffs. And if he doesn't, no pick will be met. I can't see the Flames of giving Reinhardt away for nothing. So I have a feeling it'll probably be met.
Yeah. Just have to wait and see on that one.
We have 1 fifth-round pick, which is ours. We have 2 sixth-round picks, ours in Minnesota, the one that we got for Jones, and no seventh-round picks this year.
That one, again, might be coming back due to the deal with Colorado. If Hamilton plays fewer than 18 games, then we get our seventh-round pick back. So
pretty much if he doesn't play this week, we get that pick back.
More or less, yeah. If he's not up here by Saturday, we magically get a 7th-round pick back. So,
and, you know, like you're saying, this year isn't as deep as last year's, and there's always ways that you can move these picks for other years, too. You know, if you say, hey, we've got two picks in the second, we're happy. The next guy's really not worth a second. I'm sure there's somebody that might give you, you know, a second and a fourth in another year, a second and a fifth to trade up.
Yeah, or you can use that as a tool to acquire a player. Like, say, like, Minnesota, one of the posters on Calgary Puck, the Chief, he mentioned Charlie Coyle. He makes nearly $4 million and is an RFA. That contract may be too much for them with all their other deals. Maybe you use one of those second-round picks plus something else for a guy like Coyle or some other miscellaneous Hamilton-esque type trade.
Could work.
Who knows? But at least there's options. Like, I'm sure that the Flames will be more than prepared to use all five of the top three-round picks whenever their name's called.
Or we might see some creative like they did last year.
Exactly.
So I think it's interesting, and we posted this on our Twitter feed earlier this week. I think if you look back, the Flames won the draft with both the Hamilton deal and then still being able to get Anderson and Shillington in the second round. We won the trade deadline. It's just too bad we can't win on the ice.
Yeah. Also, an interesting little note about the draft. Outside of the top 10, there is no big right winger until like the mid to late third round. So if the Flames are in an opportunity to select one of the big right wingers in this draft, I think that's who we will take. So the rest of the draft is filled with defensemen, goaltenders, left wingers, and centers. So
we need some goaltenders. We could probably use a couple defensemen.
Yeah. Oh, I agree. I think that's the likeliest group that we would select from. Might take a center. Depends.
So if we have a year with a lot of goaltenders, that tells me this is the draft year of little brothers, because the little brother always ended up having to play goal when, you know, we're growing up playing on the street.
True enough.
Well, Matt, let's look ahead to the week that's coming for the Flames. The Flames will have three games before we broadcast next. We're going to be moving our broadcast schedule to Tuesdays for the month of March because the Flames are playing pretty much every Monday until then. And then we'll go back to probably Monday in April for the one or two shows we do there. So looking ahead, the Flames will play Thursday on the road against the Buffalo Sabres. And that's a 5 p.m. Calgary start time. And then a matinee game against the Pittsburgh Penguins in Pittsburgh on Saturday, and that'll conclude their road swing, and then they will come back to Calgary on Monday for an extended home stand, and they will start that home stand against the San Jose Sharks. And if you do want to go to that home stand and you want to, you know, see the Flames with some of the new additions, don't forget that you can get your tickets from our friends at TickTix. TickTix connects the Sea of Red to buy and sell tickets securely from their phones. TickTix lets sellers sell for free and verifies the sellers so buyers don't get ripped off. Tickets are delivered digitally, so there's no hassle in trying to meet somebody and pick them up and all that sort of thing. You can download TickTix today for free in the Google Play Store or the iOS App Store. And that's, you know, we're coming to the end of the season. There's not too many home games left, and we've got six of them coming up here over 2 weeks. So if you want to go to a game, don't wait. Download TickTix and buy your tickets. Matt, 6 points on the board. What do you think we're going to do?
I'm going to go with two.
Which two?
I think we'll beat Buffalo, and yeah, that's about it.
So you went with two last week as well. You thought we'd beat Ottawa, and you ended up getting skunked.
Yeah, well, the team pretty much got skunked.
I'm going to make a secondary prediction here. I think Thursday against the Sabres, we see Backstrom start.
Could very well be.
I think that if you're going to start a guy who hasn't played in over a year, why not play him against one of the crappiest teams in the league? I think it would be almost unfair to start him against the Penguins or the Sharks.
True enough.
And I don't think they want to wait much later to get him back into the game. So I think that they're going to start Backstrom against the Buffalo Sabres, and I'm going to be less optimistic than you, which isn't really possible with 2 points. I think the Flames are going to walk out of this week with 0 points.
So you're predicting a 9-game losing streak?
Yes. I think they'll lose against. I think they'll put Backstrom in against the Buffalo Sabres. I think they'll lose that game. Maybe get a point. I think that they're gonna get blown out by the Pittsburgh Penguins because Pittsburgh always seems to. We've had some success, but they've got the players there. They'll probably overpower this team. And then I think San Jose is gonna beat us as well. So yeah, 9 games, and you know, really, I don't like to hear a team tank or try to lose, but I think right now maybe a 9-game losing streak wouldn't be the worst thing for the Calgary Flames.
No, and I hate the fact that the Flames are in this situation, but at this point, does it make any difference if you're 1 point out of a playoff spot or you're dead last?
I think you're in this situation, make the best of it. I think the more we lose, the more we've got to start bringing, I'd almost say for every loss, you or 2 losses, let's say, you bring up 1 guy from the AHL. And you sit 1 guy in the NHL, because I think you're going to have to start, you know, seeing what you've got here, and they want to bring the young players up, and we don't have many games left.
Well, I think after the homestand, I think that's when you'll start to see a lot more recalls after that point. Till then, I think the Flames will try to keep it as consistent of a product as they can.
See, I think you're going to get guys recalled. I just don't know if you're going to get them dressed. I think they're going to want to bring a couple guys up, get them practicing with the team, that sort of thing. So I'm expecting over the next week and a half, let's say by the 12th, that we're going to see most of the guys who are going to get recalled probably get recalled here. But I just want to close out by saying thank you to Chris Russell, Yari Hudler, and David Jones. All of them served here for a long time. They've all been great Flames. And it's been fun watching them. You know, we've been critical of Jones over the years. He had a good year this year. Russell, I think, has really made his name as an NHL defenseman. I mean, we paid a 5th-round pick for him, and we traded him for, like you said, a 2nd-round prospect, a 2nd-round pick, and an NHL defenseman. So, you know, buy low, sell high on that one. And Hudler, I don't think the Flames would have been in the position they were in without Hudler. He's been a mentor to Goudreau. He's been a mentor to Monahan. He's been the veteran presence we needed. So thank you, guys, and go Dallas Stars.
And actually go all 3 of your teams, have success, have fun in the playoffs, and you never know, we may see you back here in Flaming Sea next year.
I have a strong suspicion, because Russell likes Western Canada, the Oilers might break the bank to bring him in.
Could very well be.
I have this suspicion in my head that that might happen. We'll see if I'm right. I hope I'm wrong, because I really don't want him in Edmonton, but I have a strong suspicion we might see him wearing an Oilers jersey next year.
Yeah, I could see that. They did bring in Ference, after all.
Well, and I think they would be willing to overpay to sort of get that, not really a centerpiece defenseman, but okay, we've got a guy who has NHL cred, especially if he can go far in the playoffs. A guy who wants to be in Alberta. Now let's build around him. And I think he could be, for the Oilers, a decent 1-2 guy until they get their act together.
Yeah. And it you got to figure, if they've got Davidson, Nurse, Klefbom, Sakara, and then Russell, I think that would be a fairly, I wouldn't say good defense corps, but at least respectable, instead of the legions of not really NHL players that they've been running out there for the last handful of years.
Yeah, I think it shows forward motion.
Yeah. And that's the kind of steps that Edmonton needs to take, instead of being the perennial laughingstock of the league that they have been since, well, 2007, I think. So,
What I think is, I think you're going to see Chris Russell moved to the Oilers, and I think you're going to see them make a big deal of the draft to bring in another 1-2 guy for their roster. I'm not saying that Russell's a 1-2 guy somewhere like Dallas, but in Edmonton, I think you'll see him and someone else get brought in together as the 1-2 pairing.
Mm-hmm. Could very well be.
So enjoy this week. Let's hope I'm wrong and the Flames don't go winless in 9, and we will talk to you next Tuesday, Matt.
Yeah, take it easy. Thanks for listening, everybody. And have a good week.
And enjoy watching Joki Paka and the new look Calgary Flames. Fireside Chat is hosted by Dan Stevenson, co-hosted by Matt DeBorg. This episode produced and edited by Peter Marino. Fireside Chat is licensed under Creative Commons license. For full license details, visit firesidechat.ca.